Good morning. We have a request from our listening audience. How great thou art. Let's sing that together before we start worship, okay? 77? Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. At this time, do we have any announcements or prayers, anything that anyone would like to share? If you do, we'll bring mics to you.
I just wanted to thank those that lifted me up in prayer or gave me words of encouragement as I went on the mission trip to Africa and arrived safely back. So it was an awesome trip, and I, again, thank you for your guys' concern and love to share my stories with you at some point.
Actually, next Sunday would be a wonderful time, and we'll have a potluck dinner. Actually, we talked about leadership, and you weren't there, and you was coming back. But yeah, if you'd like to share after the potluck, that'd be great. And I can tell by his beaming smile, he's already getting ready. But anyway, and we'll have others share different things too, because we're going to kind of kick off, because school will be starting, and I do want you to let you know that we will all have a potluck supper after church Sunday. And are there any other announcements before I ask you to do anything else? All right.
I have two announcements, actually. I am going to start another Bible study. I'm going to facilitate it. And this one I'm going to do on Thursday mornings at 9:30. I'm not going to do a night one unless God tells me different. This was my idea to do just the one time, but that may change. So this study will be by Nancy Tanton. I think some of you are familiar with that. It's a video workbook like we've always done. The name of this study is Freedom, A Beautiful Choice. It's not on any particular book of the Bible. It is on several books. She just uses scripture as she teaches. And I just now have gotten into that study these last few days. And I tell you what, I'm really excited about it because the Lord's already spoken to me about some things that I need to take care of and change my life a little bit. And I think by going to Bible studies, that's what keeps us in tune with God. So that's why it's so important. I haven't cleared this with the church office, but I'm hoping to start this August the 29th. And then we would be finished by October 31st. And since we meet in the mornings, that won't matter that Halloween is that night. So I will need people to let me know if you're interested in coming to it so I can get the workbooks, which that's not going to be a problem because Nancy has those on hand in Wichita. The other announcement, I know this is early, but I'm going to announce it anyway. On September 5th, the United Methodist Women have our meeting, and we have a program from Whitney Barr. And Whitney's mother and I have been friends. Whitney's parents are Paul and Jenny Barr, and I've known Jenny through physical therapy. And so somehow I got on Whitney's mailing list, and she does mission work. And this summer, she went to an India mission trip, and she was gone a month. And every time I read her mail, she just brings me to tears. She's quite a young lady, and she's going to present our program on September 5th, so you'll probably be hearing me announce this more so that we can get a few people here to listen to her, because I know you will enjoy it, and I will as well. Now, David wants the microphone.
Today is Nancy's birthday, along with my grandson, Justin. We're going to Salina to celebrate that. Secondly, Pat Allen and Steve Allen had some medical procedures last week. I know they would appreciate prayers, and I know Steve has a sweet tooth. So if you have nothing else to do and you got a leftover half a cake or something, think of those people. They're good people. I really like Steve, as well as Pat.
What's that?
Okay. Thank you. I'm sure we dominated this thing, Nancy and I.
I guess I don't have much to say after that.
Oh! I didn't know you were here.
No, Pat's surgery went well. She's up and walking around with a walker now and doing a lap around the kitchen every once in a while and so forth. And my surgery went well, and just everything's great. We appreciate everyone bringing food and support and so on. It's just been great. Thank you.
That's kind of hard to follow. Ken has been on a Men's Encounter with God weekend again this week down by Ark City. As many of you know, it is a life-changing event for a lot of people. It's a time of renewing a commitment to God for other people. And then you come home, and there's always the reality that bites. So we continue to ask for your prayers for this wonderful ministry that has influenced a lot of people and have changed a lot of lives. So thank you.
Are there any others?
Yes.
Klein's birthday is Tuesday, and it is a milestone.
Women broken by sex trafficking. The mission that we exist to restore the lives of women broken by sex trafficking by providing a safe, Christ-centered home, biblical counsel, and life skills that will provide purpose for her future. And on August the 24th, 2019, at 6 o'clock at the Kansas Beach Hospitality and Events, which is 9881 West Pleasant Hill Road in Brookville, Kansas. They'll be featuring a dinner, the Rubble Family Band, and a special guest speaker. And we're going to use these funds to help get this ministry going. It says, please join us for the first annual awareness and fundraising event as we build a home for women rescued from sex trafficking. And we'll have a poster up, and you'll have a RSVP if you're interested in that. And I've been around one in Wichita, and it's a real blessing. They have a home to start a new life for women. And in Wichita, I think it's ranked fifth highest of sex trafficking in the United States. And, you know, we're not that far from Wichita, and we have I-70, we have 135, and and Murray can tell you, too, that it is an issue. It is an issue. And I'll let you know. Also, another opportunity, Ministerial Alliance is going to have a benefit fund raising. They're going to have a watermelon feed, and that'll be Saturday after the parade on August the 24th. Start about 11 o'clock during the countdown days. It'll be down by Gibbons Barbershop. If you're willing to help set up, that you'd be willing to do that, write down your name and phone number, or if you're willing to serve during that time, or if you're willing to tear down. I'll just go ahead and start that. My A isn't here. Being a man, I couldn't find the clipboard, so this is why it looks the way it does. God loves me anyway. And it isn't based on performance. Praise God. It's based on grace. All right. Are there any other announcements? Okay, Sylvia does. Okay. Or Dave does.
I just want to kind of give you the last week ago or 2 weeks ago, we flew into Sacramento. And from there, we took the bus and we seen Oregon. Part of California, then Oregon, and then Washington. We've seen them, the three mounts, Mount Hood, and Mount St. Helens, and Mount Jefferson. And then we also seen Crater Lake at the very beginning. And Crater Lake, I want to let you know, is one of the most beautiful spots I've ever seen. It is the bluest water, purest water. It's just absolutely magnificent. There's no outlet on it, but the snow from the other mountains feed into it, but it does lose its water through the porous rock of the volcanic rock. But the trip as a whole, I had to stop and thank the Lord many times. We've seen trees, trees, and more trees, but it was worth it. God's beautiful creation, what he made and still has, is wonderful. And I just thank the Lord for it.
Good morning, Lord. What a blessing it is to be in your house of worship. As many have shared different joys, different things that have been going on in their lives, dear Lord, I just thank you and praise you. As we focus on you, because as Dave said, you are so worthy. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your grace and mercy. And the opportunity to focus and worship you because you are so great. You are so worthy. I can say this, but there's many times, dear Lord, I'm holding on to hurt, frustration, brokenness. Dear Lord, just the darkness of the world that we live. Busyness is going on in our lives. Dear Lord, I wasn't meant to carry it. None of us are meant to carry it. You tell us 700 times in your word to come to you. So I pray today that we would allow you to work in our lives. That the Holy Spirit would loosen the grips of things we're so tightly holding on. That we would truly surrender and lay it at the foot of the cross. Give it to the one that can do all things. Give it to the one
that is able. Give it to the one that is not limited. Now we have empty, open hands to receive your blessings. We have empty, open hands to receive your love, your grace, your mercy, your forgiveness, your strength, your power. And gracious God, you have chosen to use us to make a difference here in Ellsworth and throughout the world, that others can receive all that we have received from you, they can receive from us. I also pray if anyone needs a special touch today, they'd feel your presence. Know they are loved, know that they are forgiven. And gracious God, know that you'll never leave nor forsake. So please minister to each and every heart. We thank you and praise you. In Jesus' precious name, all of God's kids say,
Amen.
Amen. So now let us take this time and greet each other in the love of Christ, please.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Please join me in the call to worship, number 893. Lord, we confess our day-to-day failure to be truly human.
Lord, we confess to you.
Lord, we confess that we often fail to love with all we have and are, often because we do not fully understand what loving means, often because we are afraid of risking ourselves.
Lord, we confess to you.
Lord, we cut ourselves off from each other, and we erect barriers of division.
Lord, we confess to you.
Lord, we confess that by silence, an ill-considered word, we have built up
walls and prejudice.
Lord, we confess that by selfishness and lack of sympathy, we have
stifled generosity and left little time for others.
Holy Spirit, speak to us. Help us listen to your word of forgiveness, for we are very deaf. Come, fill this moment and free us from sin. Amen.
Let us pray. Gracious God, Heavenly Father, you've heard us confess how we fall short, how much we need you. And we thank you for the Holy Spirit of continually leading us, guiding us, and directing us. That we would share love, your grace, your mercy to others. I thank you and praise you of all the praises that were shared today. Praises of a new Bible study. Praises of opportunity, dear Lord, of Next Step Ministry. Praises of Kurt coming back and after sharing the gospel in Africa. For those that went to California, Oregon, and Washington, and dear Lord, just the blessing of seeing your beautiful creation and being with others. I thank you for that. For school that'll be starting, dear Lord, this coming week, we lift up our schools. Dear Lord, we lift up the students, the staff, the teachers, the custodians, the bus drivers, the cooks, each and every one. Dear Lord, just minister to them as they minister to our students. And that our students would be reaching out to others. Dear Lord, I know college will be starting also. And so, dear Lord, whether it's preschool or graduate school, dear Lord, bless them. I thank you again for birthdays that was mentioned. I thank you again for your love and grace. Dear Lord, for those that are ill, dear Lord, for those that are going through treatments, for those that are recovering, dear Lord, keep them on our hearts and minds, that we would continually to pray for them and continually reach out to them. What a blessing that is. I thank you again for the opportunity, dear Lord, to serve you, to reach out to our neighbors, how you're using Ministerial Alliance. And dear Lord, I thank you for that. I thank you, most importantly, for your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, that died for our sins. Not only did he defeat sin, but he defeated death. That he arose, dear Lord, in 3 days. And now he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of Father Almighty, interceding for us. We thank you and praise you. Now, gracious God, we come to you in a prayer that Jesus taught the disciples. And as we say this prayer that is very common to us, that we know so well, that we would truly live out each word by your Spirit, by your grace, dear Lord, in your leading, as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven.
Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
Now at this time, we'll be singing our hymn, God of Grace and God of Glory. You'll find in your United Methodist hymnal, number 577, or on the screen. Seated. And now, do you need a mic, Deb? Yes, she does. All right. And need some hands, and anyone from the ages of 10 to 100 can help, right?
Yes. Okay. I need a few people that can pass out a few baskets here. Oh, I'm getting some help now. Judge, there's three. There you go, Alan. Thank you. As you see in the bulletin, we're collecting for the college kids postage through the year. And I am representing Pat today because she's at home getting healed up. And a shout out if she's watching us. Hey there, girl. Anyways, we are very blessed to have her do this for us, take care of our college kids and adults that are in school, and they send periodically, so every few months, stuff in the mail to them, and I know they appreciate that. And all this money we collect is for postage. And then also, I know she would want you guys to remind you to make sure you get your new addresses into the office for her, for the college kids, if they've changed or whatever. So thank you very much for supporting our Moments for Missions.
Thank you. And now we'll have young disciples. Rosemary, would you like to talk to Will and myself? I'll feel young. Will's so great that we needed an act light, and Will just jumped up and did it. And I tell you what, he is such a blessing, and we have such wonderful young adults and children in our church. And so we're here for the candy, so we're ready to listen.
Yeah. Okay. Have you ever tried to teach a person to do something?
Have you?
Yeah.
Okay. Suppose that a friend came to you and said, "Teach me how to make a peanut butter and jelly sandwich." What would you say?
Yeah. I think I could do that. Yeah.
Okay. What would be the first step? Okay. One piece of bread? Two. Okay. What would be next? Okay.
Something to spread it with?
Unless you want your fingers.
Oh, and we wash our hands for 20 seconds, and then we put on gloves. Oh, that's right.
And then finally, what do? After you put peanut butter and jelly on the bread, put them together, and then you eat the sandwich. Well, as you all know, Jesus spent much time in prayer, and he was a great teacher. One day, he went to a quiet place to pray. When he had finished, one of the disciples came to him and said, "Lord, teach me to pray." Jesus answered, "When you pray, say, 'Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us day by day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone that is indebted to us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.'" What a beautiful prayer that is. It isn't a very long prayer, but there are three things in this short prayer that every prayer should include. First of all, it praises God, our Heavenly Father. Second, it asks God to provide for what we need each day. And finally, it asks for God's forgiveness for the times that we fall short of what he expects of us. After 2,000 years, we still pray the way that Jesus taught us. So together, why don't we say the prayer? Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Okay. Now, you want some candy or do you want some cookies?
Yes. Until they run out of watermelon.
And that may be until about 1 or something like that. From about 11 o'clock a.m. to, that'd be about a couple hours. And the thing is, I haven't been told yet. I will be told Wednesday at 8:30 at the hospital what we're doing. So I'm just kind of thought, well, we better put up a sign-up sheet because next week will be the 18th. And so I'm being proactive, even though I'm probably making mistakes. But that's a gift of mine. It's not a spiritual gift. But that's an excellent question. And now you know how much I know.
I wrote my name down for
12
o'clock.
Okay. That'd be PM, right? All right. Okay. Awesome. All right. Now, we got an example, so now you know what to do. But I wish I knew more, but we haven't had the meeting, but I wanted to get it out because I know next week would be very short time. And so anyway, but awesome. And now we're going to have the praise hymn, Cry of My Heart. You'll find in the Faith We Sing, number 2165, are also on the screen. At this time, would the ushers please come forward as we have the opportunity for our offering as we're in ministry with God. Thank you. Thank you. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you and praise you for this opportunity. As we're about to receive this offering, we ask that you would bless it, that it would further your kingdom here in Ellsworth and throughout the world, the people would hear the good news of Jesus Christ, life, death, and resurrection. Dear Lord, that we have a God that has defeated sin and death. We thank you for our Lord and Savior, Jesus. Dear Lord, and not only we ask that you bless this offering, but bless each and every one that is able to participate, but not only participate financially, but of time, service, prayer, and participation, their presence. We thank you again, because we know how important it is. Just minister to each and every one of our hearts as we give in so many ways. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen.
Scripture reading this morning is from the book of Proverbs. You can find that on page 733 in your pew Bible if you care to follow along. We start with Proverbs 14:29. Whoever is slow to anger has great understanding, but one who has a hasty temper exalts folly. Our second verse is Proverbs 15, verse 1. A soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Well, today we'll be looking at the second part of anger as a secondary emotion. And before I begin and even have prayer, I want to thank you again for asking about the watermelon feed. See, no, really, we have normally have about a needs of $10,000 a year that comes through Ministerial Alliance. And we have the opportunity, we had the watermelon donated, and we pray this works well. But I didn't have much information, and it made me think of a story. It is a true story. George Beverly Shea, have you heard of him? Yeah, he's sang for Billy Graham. And he had the opportunity, you know, he normally sang, but he had the opportunity to share some words the church wanted him to preach. And his dad was an old Methodist pastor. He said, "Hey, Dad, do you have any words for me that I could share with the people?" And his father's words were, "Well, son, if God can give words to a donkey," only his dad was more of a King James guy, so he used the word ass. But he said, "If he can give words to a donkey, surely he can give some words to you." So I'm looking for words today, so I better pray. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious God, I thank you and praise you for loving us so much. And who you say we are yours. Because of Jesus, we are forgiven. And dear Lord, you look at us with eyes of love, of heart of mercy, because we struggle with so many things. We struggle with frustration, with insecurity, and how anger is a secondary emotion. It is just tip of the iceberg. So, gracious God, I just ask that you'd give me the words today, that they'd be your words and not mine, that we'd have a greater understanding and interpretation, application of your word for our lives. I thank you and praise you for this. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. Well, how are we doing on this anger? Are you guys enjoying this? Okay, just think, I only got 6 more sermons. And Tammy says, great. You know what it is to pick out songs for anger each and every week. But she wasn't angry with me when she told me that. I'm sure she wasn't. But anger is a secondary emotion. I mean, there's many times we get upset and we bolt to anger, because we've been hurt, as we talked about last week, because we've been hurt because unmet needs have been met. We feel either it's perceived or real, but unmet needs have not been met. Well, today we'll look at the second and the third and so number 2 on your bulletin, if you see that line and you have a pencil or pen, you can put frustration. Frustration is either real or perceived unmet expectations. From Proverbs 14:29, a patient man has great understanding, but a quick-tempered man displays folly. If we're patient, we allow God to reveal to us, and we just don't bolt to anger, but if we're quick-tempered, it does display folly. When I look at this frustrations, many times what we do, we put shoulds or shouldn'ts, or how we should act or even dress in church, or what songs we should sing or shouldn't sing, or many other things. Like, because after I got married, I would expect that I would never have any more problems. I thought you might laugh at that one, okay? But after children get 24 years old, we do not have to help them financially anymore. Okay. I'm glad. Thanks, Deb, you're helping me out. But you know, many times these shoulds or shouldn'ts or what you should say or shouldn't say, many times we put those expectations even on ourselves. That I'll always have that project done on time. Or I should do this or I shouldn't do that. And many times we can also be frustrated with ourselves. I want us to look at some biblical examples. Naaman in 2 Kings chapter 5, verses 11 through 12. This is what 2 Kings has to say. But Naaman became angry and went away, saying, I thought that for me he would surely come out. He is talking about Elijah the prophet. Stand and call on the name of the Lord, his God, and would wave his hand over the spot and cure this leprosy. Are not Aman and Phapar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all these waters of Jordan, of Israel? Could I have not washed in them and be clean? He turned and went away in rage. Because he had expectations of this prophet. He wasn't ready to be obedient. But he had expectations. Surely this prophet would do this or do that. Can you see the frustration? Can you see the frustration? But when he finally was obedient and dipped himself 7 times in the Jordan, he was cleansed of the leprosy. Now Michael, David's wife. In 1 Chronicles 15:29. As the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord came to the city of David, Michal, daughter of Saul, looked out of the window and saw King David leaping and dancing, and she despised him in her heart because of expectations. How could a king act this way? You see, her father was once king. And she's watching David come in the city of Jerusalem, so excited, bringing in the Ark of the Covenant. He's dancing and praising God, and he probably even showed his underwear. What kind of king would do that? She despised him. Also, know from reading, she was the only one of his wives that didn't have a child. She despised him. See the expectations that we can put up. And because of these unmet expectations, we bolt to anger because of our frustrations. So what tool do we have? Last week when we talked about hurt, the tool was to talk about how I feel about something. Today, how to communicate your frustration, we need to look at I desire versus I demand expectations. I desire instead of I demand. You know, the I demand, it ought to be this way or should always be this way or should or maybe always or never. But if I desire this happen. I long for this to happen. I hope for this because we live in a fallen world. things don't always turn out like our expectations. But if I desire, if I long for, if I hope for, when things don't quite go the way the expectations I have, I won't just bolt to anger. I'll probably do as Proverbs 14:29. I'll sit back and I'll look at the situation. What is going on? So I desire versus I demand expectations. So number three in your line is insecurity equals real or perceived attack on my personal worth. Anger is often evidence of insecurity in my life. Anger is often evidence. That's the second or the next line after number three. Anger is often evidence. I want us to look at some examples. Some Bible examples. And Saul, we talked about his daughter Michal. Because Michal was actually promised to David, or promised to anyone that would take out that giant Philistine, Goliath. And then when I look at the evidence in 15:1, a gentle answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. Saul in 1 Samuel 18:5 through 8, after David defeated Goliath, the people were singing, David killed, well, Saul killed 1,000 and David had killed 10,000. They were praising David. Instead of Saul saying, you know, I've empowered one of God's people to defend his country. I need to empower more so we can do God's work. No, he got upset. He wanted to take David's life. He's thinking, you know, the people are getting behind him. I may no longer be king. I got to get rid of this guy. When I think of this, inadequacy produces fear rooted in shame. Inadequacy or insecurity creates a fear of others seeing me as I am. So I hide. In Genesis chapter 3, verse 8, after Adam and Eve had sinned against God, they ate of the fruit. They tried to cover themselves. They were hiding from God because they knew God would be walking with them in the coolness of the evening. And the words to Adam, Adam, where are you? Adam, where are you? And ever since the fall, we realize we are inadequate. He knew he had sinned. He was hiding from God because of his inadequacy. He said, I'm over here, God. I'm hiding because I'm naked. We know in chapter 2, they were naked, but they were unashamed. But now they could see their inadequacy because of the fall, because of sin. We're all inadequate. I want us to look also at the Jewish leaders in Acts 5, verses 12 through 18, because God was doing mighty things in Jerusalem. The disciples, after Jesus ascended into heaven, was freeing people that were oppressed, that were demon-possessed, that were sick, that needed healing, needed a touch, even as Peter would walk by, even a shadow, people were being healed. And a high priest, instead of saying, you know what? These 12 were right. Jesus is who they said he was. He is the Messiah. No. They were upset. They were filled with indignation. And they actually even sent the disciples into prison. Instead of being excited what God was doing, healing people and adding numbers daily to those that follow Jesus Christ, they were so upset that they even had people thrown in prison. So we're a tool for when we're insecure. We need to ask ourselves, why am I feeling threatened? What is being attacked? Who is being attacked? Who's attacking me? And is the threat menial or meaningful? Whose approval am I seeking? And the first step in overcoming this destructive power of anger is the courage to look below the surface. Remember last week we talked about how anger is like the light on the dashboard of your vehicle. And today, not only do you just pop open the hood to see what's going on, but you have to take it to a mechanic that has the capability to be able to hook it up into the computer and see exactly all what is going on. Like I said, anger is like an iceberg. It's only the tip of it that we see, but 90% of it is below the surface, below the water surface. When I think about being attacked, I had the opportunity here the last few weeks ago of being maybe in a community where there might be over 500,000 people in the Kansas City area and driving to St. Joe. And, you know, they wave at you just like you guys wave, but maybe they use less digits when they wave at you when you're driving, I've noticed. And then when someone does that, I don't know about you, but I can find myself being upset that someone's upset at me. Because then my insecurity kicks in, and I need to actually think, well, you know what? Maybe I wasn't watching what I should have done. Or even if I was doing the right thing, I need to not let that bother me. Because we all make mistakes. I don't need to just get all upset. Or have you ever noticed, because I was there a few times when you're driving and then you slow down to one lane and there's always one guy that goes clear on the shoulder going 80 miles per hour and then squeezes in and wants to get in front of you? How do you handle that? I mean, it doesn't make sense that, well, I'll take care of him. I'll just ram him. No. You say, oh, God be with that person. I don't know what's going on in his life. Does any of this sound familiar? Okay, I'll give you another example. My father had a stroke. It'll be 11 years in October. And, you know, last year my mother had a stroke a week Christmas. But my mom's stroke was slight. My dad was quite severe. And dad isn't able to drive. He isn't even able to really talk like he would like to. But he can still communicate in certain ways. Like when you're driving down the road, you go, ah! Like that, you start swerving. And I think, I know why my mom gets upset. But because I knew that, I didn't have the insecurity saying, now, Dad, I know we're in a parking lot. I know we have a little blue plastic thing hanging in the rearview mirror. I've been driving for almost 40 years. I can find those lines. I can even find that sign. And I know where to park. No, I didn't do that. That's okay, Dad. But I said, Dad, have you ever noticed many times where that blue sign is, I can actually get us a few steps ahead sometimes when it's open that we can, so we can even actually walk closer, but I understand, and that's where we need to park. So that's not a problem. Unless you're in Branson, Forget it. I'd never seen so many handicapped people in one place. Just saying. All right. Boy, God's working on me. I don't know about you guys. But yes, this insecurity is real. And that problem, the problem is not anger. And many times when this starts coming at you, you got to remember we're in a fallen world. And you also got to remember who God says you are. You've been made in the image of God. You are loved. You're forgiven. And God is with you. And God can use this anger for good if we turn to Him, if we turn to God. Let us pray. Gracious God, I just thank You and praise You for this time. Yes, there's times that we're hurt because of unmet needs. There's times of frustration because of unmet expectations. And also insecurity because we've been attacked or maybe perceived any way of our personal worth. And dear Lord, we thank You for these tools. We thank You for loving us. And that we would treat people the way that You desire for us to treat. Because they're special to You also. They've been made in Your image. That we would show love, that we would show grace. Just as our Lord and Savior did Jesus. We thank You again. In Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen. Now, if you're comfortable standing, would you please stand and sing, Be Still My Soul, number 534. 534, Be Still My Soul. before the benediction, I want us to remember Frona. I forgot to mention her during prayer. She's been in the hospital this last week. So please keep Frona in your thoughts and prayers. Gracious God, we thank you and praise you. We're never alone. You are there for us. And the strength and the hope that we have in you, just leaning in you, allowing the Holy Spirit to work in our lives so we can be more like Jesus. Come, Holy Spirit, minister our hearts, minister to our heart, and that we would show that love and grace to others. I send them out in your power. Power of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. God bless you all.